the Solvent Extractors Association of India and Global presents Song of Harmony on behalf of the entire edible oil industry, dedicated towards our nation and humanity.
सर पे ये केसरी रंग सजाया है। मेरी जमीन अफसोस नहीं जो तेरे लिए सौ दर्द सहे, महफूज रहे तेरी आन सदा, चाहे जान मेरी ये रहे ना रहे। कभी रंग तेरा जिस्मों से निकल के खून कहे। तेरी मिट्टी में मिल जावा, गुल बन के मैं खिल जावा, इतनी सी है दिल की आरजू। तेरी नदियों में बह जावा, तेरे खेतों में लहरावा, इतनी सी है दिल की आरज़ू। सरसों से भरे खलियान मेरे, जहाँ झूम के भंगड़ा पा न सका, आबाद रहे वो गांव मेरा, जहाँ लौट के वापस जा न सका। ओ वतनावे मेरे वतनावे, तेरा मेरा प्यार निराला था, कुर्बान हुआ तेरी असमत पे, मैं कितना नसीबों वाला था। तेरी मिट्टी में मिल जावा, गुल बन के मैं खिल जावा, इतनी सी है दिल की आरज़ू।
Ladies and gentlemen, it is our pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar on the demand-supply situation of oil mills and future outlook, brought to you by the Solvent Extractors Association of India and Globe Oil.
Okay, now it's done.
Now it's done.
Okay, fine. Good morning, friends. Whichever part of the world you are in, I'm sure India and the world would smile again, as the song just over actually said. Welcome to the webinar on oil mills organized by Fraternity. This is our second attempt at conducting a webinar. The huge response and attendance at the first webinar on vegetable oils gave us confidence at hosting another one on oil mills. The response this time is also wonderful, and we have almost 600 delegates attending from different parts of the world. Mehta ji and his C team, along with Kailash Bhai and his Globe Oil team, have worked tirelessly to put this together. We thank them for their efforts. Friends, we are honored at the presence of Shri O.P. Chaudhary, Joint Secretary in Animal Husbandry Department as observer. He would be sharing his views today and hopefully share government policy interventions to breathe life back into this important sector of our economy. We also have among us Shri Ashok Dalwai, Chairman, Doubling Farmers' Income, Madam Shubha Thakur, Joint Secretary, Agriculture, Madam Mukta Shekhar, Joint Secretary, Food, Dr. S.K. Malhotra, Agriculture Commissioner, Dr. Barak, Additional Commissioner, Agriculture, as well as Mr. Ashok Kumar, Director in the Commerce Ministry. We are also blessed with the presence of many past presidents, plus our friend, philosopher and guide, Dorab Bhai from Singapore. We are also delighted to have Mr. Nadir Godrej, a rare poet, industrialist amongst us. We welcome and thank them all for attending this webinar. Friends, the last few months have been very tough for our poultry sector as well, as rumors were spread on the social media that non-veg food was the main culprit for the spread of corona. This motivated and false news practically killed our industry. Prices of chicken fell like 9 pence and demand for feed just vanished. We are lucky that finally better sense has prevailed and more informed and correct messages have helped in educating the consumer. However, demand is still struggling to reach the pre-COVID days. Even the aqua sector has been in trouble as Europe and USA are big markets for shrimp are also in lockdown. No wonder demand has dissipated. One sector which has been doing reasonably well is the dairy sector. In spite of massive supply chain challenges, they are doing a wonderful job of ensuring smooth supply of milk, which is an essential commodity for Indians. Let me place on record the wonderful job which Amul has been doing in ensuring supply of milk in our state of Gujarat. Without milk, Amul milk, life in splendid isolation would have been a real torture. We thank Amul wholeheartedly for the same. With lockdown being eased gradually and massive stimulus to kickstart the economy by the finance minister, we are hopefully entering the last phase of our ordeal. The worst seems to be behind us, and time is now ripe for joining the battle for revival of our sector. To discuss all these issues, we have lined up an array of speakers who are experts and have hands-on experience. Honestly speaking, none of them needs any introduction. Among the speakers, we have Mr. Balram Yadav, MD of Godrej Agrovet, Shri R.S. Sodhi, better known as the Amul Man, Devesh Bhai, Chairman SOPA and the Prestige Group, Mr. Gulrez Alam, Director, IB Group, and last but not the least, Shri Vijay Sardana, one of the foremost commentators on the agri scene in India currently. We would now request Shri O.P. Chaudhary Ji, Joint Secretary in the Animal Husbandry Ministry, to kickstart the proceedings. I hope he is already joined. Mehta Ji is here. Is Mr. Chaudhary?
I think he is with the minister. He will join later. He will join little later.
Okay, fair enough.
So I think we can go with the first speaker, sir. Yeah.
So we will request Sodhi to start the batting. Mr. Sodhi, the Amul Man, would be the opening batsman as far as this webinar is concerned. Over to Sodhi ji. Thank you. Sodhi ji, now you can take over.
Good morning, Atul ji, and good morning to all the panel members, participants. It's our privilege that today I'm able to talk to all the stakeholders of Solvent Extraction Association and all the other stakeholders related to the oil mill and the cattle feed or the poultry feed or other type of animal feed segments. Well, aapne Atul ji, already you have appreciated the dairy sector of India, so we are thankful. And all this has happened because of the support given by everybody. I mean, besides the our supply chain partners, whether farmers or transporters or the workers or the C&F or loaders, government as machinery, state and center really helped us a lot. Proactively, everybody helped us. That is why we could ensure that uninterrupted supply chain of milk and milk product was there. Not a single minute we had the stoppage. In fact, our supply chain increased by 15 to 20% because we started getting more milk. I mean, today also Amul is getting around 35 lakh liters more milk because small people and private sector, they are not procuring. So that much more milk is coming. Today also we are running at the peak what we used to get in the January. So you can understand, so all our plants are running, some are running more than 100%. So, but and demand is also fortunately is good. Milk sale is initially it had gone down because we thought that Horeca segment, which contributes 15%, will impact our sale. But whatever we have lost in the Horeca segment, much more we got it from the household. I think people sitting at home are consuming more than when they go out to the office or then when they are out. So food is lucky that during COVID, it is not, I'm talking about Amul or milk. We checked with all our counterparts. If all food consumption, especially packed and processed food consumption demand has increased. There have been some hiccups in the supply chain, some products, and I think they'll be able to cover up as the more relaxation is coming. So coming to the dairy sector, because in the dairy sector, the requirement of oil mill or cattle feed is very essential because it's the food and it's the feed. And as you know, India is the world's largest producer of milk. We are producing right now around 189 million metric tons, which translates to around 510 million liters of milk per day. And out of that, around 40% is retained by the farmers in the villages, and 60% is surplus. Out of the 60% surplus, 1/3 is coming to the organized sector and 2/3 still going to the unorganized sector. So today, our organized sector is getting more than 100 million liters of milk per day. And what we expect is that in the next 10 years, the milk production in India will double. Because, I mean, from 189 to we'll be producing minimum around 330 million metric ton. So you can say around we'll be producing every day around 1,000 liters, 1,000 million liters or 1 billion liter per day. I mean, it will be 5 to 6 times of what USA will be producing, or around 2.5-3 times what whole Europe is will be producing. Today already we are producing 2 times more than the USA and 25% more than the whole of Europe. And I was talking yesterday some press people that Atmanirbharta, people talk and people, some people laugh away ki how can India become Atmanirbhar in energy, lakhs of crores is imported, how can we become Atmanirbhar in electronics, lakhs of crore rupees imports are there, and how can India become Atmanirbhar in edible oil, 70 to 80,000 crore rupees edible oil imported. So I told mid-70s, same situation was the milk. We were not Atmanirbhar. We were dependent on imports. And that time, Indian farmers, Indian policy makers, and Indian political leadership decided that we'll become Atmanirbhar. So our policy framework, operational framework started. We had a very good model. Amul which was replicated all over India. And by mid-90s, we become world largest producer of milk. And Atmanirbhar, today we have got the surplus. So, I mean, for India, nothing is impossible because we have got the resources, we have got the manpower, and biggest advantage which no other country can today can say is we are world's largest, fastest growing market. So any product we can definitely become Atam. So more we become Atam Nibbar, I think more is the opportunity for all the industry, including the solvent extraction industry, which is more, I think right now, more dependent on export. I think Atam Nirbhata means not only depending Atam Nirbhar on imports, but also Atam Nirbhar more on domestic market than on export market, which is very, very vulnerable to the world fluctuation. And we have seen what has happened to the crude oil producing countries, how overnight their economy has been shattered. So if any industry is too much dependent on export market, one has to be very, very careful about the future. So again, coming back to the dairy, today organized sector is getting 100 million liters, which will increase to another 10 years to around 300 million liters. And you see, in dairy industry, feed is the biggest cost. Cost of production, 70% is the feed cost. Any animal, cow, buffalo, and we have got around 300 million cows and buffalo. I'm talking about all the milch cattle, milk animal. And generally, I mean, we feed dry grass, green fodder, de-oil cakes, and concentrated cattle feed of 18-20% protein. Today, if you see, the total feed market of India, looking to, because the total whatever feed is required, is around 700 crore rupees per day. Or people would earn 700 crore means around 7 billion rupees per day. That is the feed market. How much is the organized concentrated feed? How much is the dual cake? How much green fodder? That is a separate issue. But other developed countries, if you see, 50% is minimum is the organized market, like concentrates like DL cake or the cattle feed. And today, if you see in India, out of a 700 crore, only cattle feed market is only 100 crore per day. And 20% is what Amul is every day selling, 20 crore rupees cattle feed. We are also selling every day. And in cattle feed, 50% cost is of protein and fat, which is coming from the DR cake only, or DRB, etc., whatever is the thing. So you can understand, if today that 50 crore multiply by 365, around 70 to 18,000 crore rupees market is there already for oil cake industry, and which can multiply within next 10 years by maximum. So if you leave aside breeding, feeding is basically how to feed well, because we can't afford more number of milch animals. We have to see how to increase the productivity, and productivity animals beside the breeding, feeding is most important. So actually, milch animal industry, and we are looking very good alternative solution for best conversion of feed into the milk. So what I feel is, you will be the better judge how much that market is coming to the your industry. If today 1 lakh, you see 700 crore means around more than 2 lakh crore industry is there already feeding. And how much is coming to the your industry? It should be 50% should be yours. Cattle feed cost 50% is oil cake. How much? I mean, that is the potentiality you have got. Because what I feel is, still the Indian oil mill industry has more and more focus on export than developing the local industries. And looking to that, I think the maximum potential in India is human food is there, more is the cattle feed ingredients. And coming to the demand increase, a minimum 10 to 12% increase in demand can happen. But simultaneously, what we are, I think, all people who are in the fee industry, we are also looking for the very efficient and affordable alternate. Competition is coming from the alternative like DDGS, because that is maybe the also coming from corn gluten feed. Also, biggest competition, which I mean, now everybody is working to get the CLEG or seaweed, especially for the poultry and other thing. That is going to be the competitor. And also, we have started also working on the other non-conversion sources like mango kernel, tamarind seed. Moringa powder is working. I mean, it has got 30 to 40% powder. We have got now hundreds of acres of field where we are growing moringa and experimenting with the dry moringa, adding in the cattle feed to meet the requirement of protein, because Indian protein cost right now is slightly higher for animal which is being exported. Similarly, groundnut. So what in the end, what I want to say is cattle feed demand is going to be increased. It is up to the oil mill industry how much chunk you want out of it and how you can exploit that thing, how you can change your product meeting the requirement. Second is, I don't know why there are so many layers between the oil mill manufacturer and the buyer like us. I mean, there are two or three layers of agents are there. Why don't you have some website, some NCDs where we can buy thousands of metric tons of oil directly, DLK? I mean, why we have to go through layers of agents? I mean, today's world, why the agents are there? Why no plant owner, factory owner is directly selling to the user? And second is now with the FSSAI including cattle feed in their standards. And day before also we had a talk with the chairperson. I mean, that is the area where they have to too much devote that cattle feed should be part of FSSAI. Because their standards are not. So they'll ask for the, especially the aflatoxin level, et cetera, called you want us to see how to meet the aflatoxin level, et cetera, also. So I think for DOL cake industry, cattle feed industry has the maximum opportunity because India is going to be the fastest and largest market for the milk or even poultry. And also, when we want to become the biggest and fastest, naturally we'll be requiring more feed. And organized sector is growing, and organized sector will be looking for more concentrated feed because we do not have more of green fodder land, field sector. So now it is up to the industry how you can exploit it. So I wish all the best to all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sodhi ji, for that wonderful, clear thought process as far as the cattle feed requirement for the dairy industry in the country is concerned. Now we will move on to Sri Balram Yadav, MD of Godrej. He is a well-known name in the country. Over to Balram ji.
So, good morning, friends, and thank you very much, SEA, for inviting us to share our views on our sector. We all represent close to 7 lakh crores of GDP, total animal agriculture. This is our contribution in nominal terms. And I will take whatever Mr. Sodhi said forward, that we are Atmanirbhar in animal protein as far as this country is concerned. We produce enough milk, enough eggs, enough chicken, enough fish, and enough shrimp. And we produce so much shrimp that we are the largest exporter also. The good news, because of the collective effort of the SEA, oil mill industry, and our farmers, we are Atmanirbhar in the feed also. So what I will do is that I will run through the current situation with a little bit of background in each of our segments. I will talk about poultry, both broiler and layer, and I'll also talk about aqua. And then I'll touch about a few things which are happening in the industry, which are relevant to the audience here. So let me tell you that, as Mr. Atul said, that it was a disastrous February and March for us in in broiler feed and broiler segment because of the rumors the broiler am I audible, sir?
Yeah.
Okay. So because of the broiler situation, the consumption really fell to almost 30-35%. We were already producing more, and broiler industry suffered huge losses, according to me, to the tune of close to about 20,000 crores in February and March, as we had to destroy chicken worth 1,000 of crores and sell chicken at 4-5 rupees a kilo because there were no takers. Having said that, the feed demand has also dropped in broiler particularly. We are today operating at about 30-35%. Of course, the prices have gone down because we have seen that these rumors have a shelf life and they die. The consumption comes back, the prices are very high, but the integrators and the farmers are very badly hit. Almost negligible cash with the players. Working capital is already stretched. And we believe that demand will take 6 to 9 months to come back. As the out-of-home consumption increases in all things, demand will come back. But this time it will take a longer time. There will be a gradual increase in poultry consumption and poultry production also. My sense is that we are today at about 40-45% level. And we will get to about 100% level depending on when COVID fades away and when out-of-home consumption comes back. So we should be ready for a long haul. The prices have become remunerative. Prices are above 100 rupees a kilo. Cost of production is around 80. So we are still again in the positive profit zone. But whatever.
I think we are experiencing some network issues with our speakers region. So please bear with us. Thank you very much.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Balram. Yeah. Now we can hear you.
Sorry. So in egg, I think we are producing at about 80% of our normal levels. One of the things about egg is that people have more faith than anything else on egg. The consumption is also very secular. So it is likely to come back faster. I think the government has to restore midday meal consumption in most of the states, which has been suspended. Once that happens, egg will be back. So there is a good and bad news from the fish sector. I'll complete my points very quickly. Fish feed consumption is very good because fishes are in the pond. The harvesting has not happened, which is not a good news for us because the weight is going up. And once this happens, the fish value comes down. The prices of fish are coming down because Eastern India is the biggest consumer of fish. So today we are happy that the fish feed sales is good, but in future, not likely to happen. But in case harvesting does not happen, the placement of fish will be delayed. So we are keeping our fingers crossed. We hope as India opens up, fish consumption will go up significantly. And once that happens, fish industry will be back. But consumption of feed will be delayed by 2-3 months. So all oil meal producers can keep that in mind. Shrimp is a very interesting story. Mr. Atul pointed out about what is happening in shrimp industry. Yes, out-of-home consumption in Europe, America tanked. And we are the big exporters to these two continents. Almost 50% of our shrimp went there. And the prices collapsed because there were no takers at one time, and government came out with an excellent scheme of minimum support price of 260 rupees for 40 count. But I think the China is a black box in viruses, both human and shrimp. Suddenly, we saw a big surge in demand from China. And in last 2-3 weeks, Chinese demand has really gone up significantly. People are still guessing whether they are value-adding and re-exporting or virus is causing damage to their industry. The news has still not come out. So shrimp industry has started doing well. I must also tell you the 40 count prices have gone 310. rupees per kilo, which is a very remunerative price. I hope it continues. The only problem in both fish and shrimp is going to be the broodstock, because seed availability will be a problem. India needs huge quantities of broodstock, particularly in shrimp. Most of it comes from Americas, mainly Hawaii. Once the cargo flights starts coming in, the situation is likely to improve. Having said that, fish and shrimp, both industry is in a good shape. I'm sorry. It is in a good shape right now. Things should open up so that fish consumption start, and seed availability and brood stock availability has to improve. According to me, the industry is about 1.5 to 2 months late in terms of restocking. But my sense is that it will happen, and we will get back to normal conditions in a few months' time. Having said that, I must tell you that a lot of support is needed for the industry to maneuver through these bad times. And I think biggest support is working capital through the banking system, because that is where most of the money has dried up. To my oil meal friends, I just want to say that government is coming up with the regulation in the feed sector, mainly in cattle feed, to control aflatoxin at milk levels to less than 5 ppb. And I think today, whatever data we have collected internally, I think we are much ahead of that. And most of the, I think, oil meal sector has to play a very important role in help cattle feed manufacturers control aflatoxins. So there is a great responsibility both of us have to make sure that we produce high quality cattle feed. I also wish to reiterate whatever Mr. Sodhi has said, that protein prices are a killer as far as this country is concerned. Why we are not able to export poultry feed is because our corn prices and the meal prices are always much higher than global prices. At one time, we were a large exporter to Bangladesh for corn. And if you see, we almost do negligible exports because Brazilian, Argentinian corn is cheaper than Indian corn. So that has to be kept in mind. All of us are working on alternative protein for poultry as well. It can be insect protein. It can be single cell protein. A lot of technologies are coming. There are huge amount of startups. So your competition in future may not be oil meals only. It may be protein sources which have been unconventional, because the kind of requirement the industry has, and you know that we consume 75, 80, 85% of all whatever you produce. And I'm sure that all the technologies and all the expenditure on those technologies can easily pay for in case we discover cheap sources of protein. So I think to my friends in the government, never waste a good crisis. This sector requires a lot of reform. And I think this is the ideal situation. We are Atmanirbhar, but we are also fast growing. We needed a little bit of support. And my sense is that please, particularly in agriculture sector, don't miss this crisis. You can reform anything you want. No question will be asked. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Very well put. And put the right perspective. Now, to give a flavor of soya, which is a very important ingredient as far as the poultry feed and all other feeds is concerned, we have the doyen of soya industry, Devesh Bhai, Chairman SOPA and Chairman Prestige Group, to share his thoughts. Over to Devesh Bhai.
Namaskar and a very good afternoon to all the esteemed panelists, our respected senior government officials, and friends from our trade and industry, and all respected members attending this webinar. Thank you, Atul Bhai, for inviting me to this important session, which, when the entire oil meal, I would say, sector is looking for a new vision and direction after the damage caused by several elements culminating into COVID-19. Or say soybean meal and rapeseed meal, which are the biggest contributor to the oil meal exports, are subject of my deliberation, where I would primarily deal with soybean meal for in the next few minutes. one important factor was that, number one, the most of our products, as we know, is going for use by poultry and aquaculture. And now a good amount of it start being used for human food applications. Most Western world nations who are the large producers, particularly Argentina, Brazil, and USA, have large surpluses for the exports to non-soy producing countries around the world. One major factor, important factor, I would say, which we should keep in mind is the GM soybean versus non-GM variety of the crop. We believe that although the yields is said to be higher in GMOs, the natural purity derived and the quality bioavailability of the protein in case of non-GMO variety is where we have our own niche. Major producing countries do produce primarily the genetically modified soybeans, which are certainly more price competitive. So let me give a little historical perspective to the subject of soy meal exports. We exported close to 44 lakh tons of soybean meal and other soy value-added products in the year 2013. That was valued over rupees 15,000 crores. And this was our peak, I would say, in our history. But things started changing fast. And in just 3 years down the line, our exports fell to just about 4 lakh tons. And that was only valued at 1,500 crores, which was merely 10% of our peak exports. So between 2013-14 and 2014-15, we had two consecutive bad crops due to inclement weather conditions, primarily hit by excessive rains in 1 year and another year due to drought, which resulted in such a drastic fall in our exports. So ever increasing soybean prices led by the government mandated MSP in India, which rendered us uncompetitive. There were some quality issues on account of unscrupulous practices and inconsistency of supplies, which also hindered our regular exports. We did gain on exports in subsequent years, and I would say with the help from coming from the government, particularly Ministry of Commerce and Industry, and innovative marketing efforts undertaken by SOPA while I was the chairman, and took export marketing missions to the key overseas markets for regaining our lost ground. In the current year, however, we have had a double whammy hit by a poor crop on account of excess rainfall and a host of other compounding factors, including COVID-19. As per SOPA's estimates, the country's soy meal production during October 2019 to April 2020 declined. Soy meal production declined to 35.8 lakh tons against 51.84 lakh tons during the same period last year. Now, coming to the soy meal exports, during the same period, that is October 2019, through April 2020, there was a sharp decline of exports, and it was merely 3.89 lakh tons compared to 17.64 lakh tons in the previous year of the same period. The global picture is that the world production of soybean is at a high level of 365 million tons, and that of soybean meal is about 245 million tons. And that has been going up. As we all know, about 80% comes from the three major producing countries, Brazil, USA, and Argentina, while Argentinian soybean meal holds the lion market share in exports. So when we say, when we see ourselves, we are merely 3% of the world production. So we are a small player in that way. So let me dive deep into the challenges faced by India on export of export front of soybean meal. So with what I mentioned, higher raw material prices as compared to the competition due to a host of reasons. The soybean prices is essentially driven by increasing MSP, fixed most of the time on political considerations. While on the other hand, in the last 3 years, we have seen international prices kept on declining because of production surging from a level of, in 5 years, from 265 to 365 million tons. So that is the major growth in the production worldwide, which caused prices to slide internationally. Practices in the market of futures trading, I would say, on NCDEX has made life of genuine producers and processors very difficult. Players in the market with a lesser stake have speculated the price beyond the range of competitiveness. In the peak season this year, speculative prices literally drove us out of the business. High cost of logistics, such as inland freight costs to the ports and various domestic destinations, the high port charges, the biggest soybean producing state, which is Madhya Pradesh, and also having the largest crushing capacity, is about 800 kilometers from the ports on the western coast, which calls for, I would say, considering some inland freight subsidies and port charges to be subsidized for exports, because this is an item of derived from agriculture. High financing charges and unreasonably high burden, coupled with cheaper edible oil imports. When we say cheaper, the world prices have sharply declined in past 3 years. And the import tariffs, which are lower than the WTO bound rates, which all makes our oil meals, which are the other product after crushing, becoming more costly to us. So to keep ourselves, I would like to take a cue from the pulses industry. You see, when there was a shortage, we had huge imports coming into the country. The prices in the process surged to a very high level. And within a year and two, not only that, the high prices incentivized the farmers to move to pulses cultivation. They made us near self-sufficient for our needs, going our own production to in excess of 20 million tons. So that shows that the crop diversification is possible through those incentives which are available to the farmers. When we have better production, and if the government can, I would also come to that point, how we can deal with that matter. We have what we need is basically to change how we can move towards self-sufficiency in edible oils, for which I think the government is now, I'm giving all special attention. What then, my friends, is the way forward? I'm sure you will agree that there are two factors that will win us into the export market. One is the competitive pricing, and secondly, consistent availability of the quality product. So in this respect, I propose the following steps should be taken. The farmers should be encouraged to grow more soybean under income-driven MSP. And the government should incentivize the farmers either by a scheme called Bhavantar, which was very successfully introduced in Madhya Pradesh, or by the yield per hectare kind of a subsidy. This is possible by increasing our per hectare yields from the current low of 1 ton per hectare to at least 1.6 tons per hectare. And our immediate target should be placed to go up to 2 tons per hectare of productivity. So there is a national mission in edible oil, and that I would strongly. So now what I would suggest that the government must make all our export activity free of all taxes and levies, which we have to pay high mandi fee currently and some other VAT on some of the GST inputs and consumables which we are not qualified for ITC. Secondly, the MEIS benefit, which used to be about up to a year before, was available at 10%, which was subsequently reduced to 7%. Now, currently, being given only at 5% up to December 2020. So our appeal to the government would be to reconsider it, to make it at least 10% to keep us having our competitive edge in the market, although we are still priced higher. But rather than, I would say, to compete on the bulk markets, which are large consumers, we must search for our niche markets who can pay us premium for our non-GMO soybean meal and other soya value-added products, especially in the light of COVID-19 pandemic. Because people would prefer consumption of non-genetically modified products at all stages of the food chain. Production acreages needs to be enhanced with earnest efforts to achieve higher per hectare yields. We have to jointly make concerted efforts, I would say, to win in the lost markets. In the joint effort, we need the help of the farmer, the government, the processor community. The thrust on Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So in my opinion, the government should lay the thrust towards making India self-sufficient in edible oils, but it can be achieved only through higher indigenous acreage coupled with higher productivity in the oilseed sector. We must work together towards the national food and nutritional security through the edible oils and protein supply without compromising self-reliance. And finally, I would like to inform you that I have been in conversation with the honorable policymakers on behalf of SOPA and have already made several representations as recently as the last fortnight. I hope we can together make soy meal exports of India with our USP to earn a sizable foreign exchange earner for our country. Thank you, friends.
Thank you, Devesh Bhai, for those wonderful words. And I'm sure whatever.
Atulji, I would like to add something.
Yeah, bolie.
See, yesterday SEA compiled the data for exports of oil meal. This year, for 1920, the export is down by about 27%. In fact, the soybean meal, the last year was just 6,82,000 tons only, compared to 30 lakhs last year. Rapeseed was last year 10.9. This year is a 9.61, so not much gone down. And of course, the total export during the oil finance year 2019-20, the total export is a 20.1 million tons compared to last year 33 lakh tons. Sorry, that 33 lakh tons. And value-wise, look at the, this year, we are on about 4,400 crores, which was last year was 6,400 crores. So both in terms of the quantity, we are down by 27%. In we are down by 31%. This is just for info of the audience. Thank you. Go ahead, please, sir.
Just to add one thing, in last, after this dip to a lowest of 3.89 lakh tons in the year 15-16 crop year, we went with our export promotion efforts and revived this markets to achieve in 3 years 60 lakh tons of exports and about 18 lakhs, 20 lakhs and 21.5 lakh tons. So put together about 60 lakh tons in 3 years, which was, I would say, was a good recovery for a commodity or a product which obtained in the international market for that long. Because 2 years we were, almost, away from international markets because of the bad crop in India, which I mentioned. So this could certainly actually be revived. As a matter of fact, exports can only give us, I would say, stability in the market and give a balance, to so that we can, have better pricing both for domestic and export needs. Otherwise, we find that there is not enough of offtake for whatever we are producing. So exports are an essential leg for us, and that needs to be, in any way encouraged and, I would say, to be sustained. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Devesh Bhai, for those wonderful words. But let me tell you, with the high MSP, as you rightly pointed out, exports can only happen with massive infusion of incentives. Without high incentives and with the world awash in meal and in beans, exporting soybean meal will always remain a challenge because India is a high-cost country. So the next speaker on our webinar is Mr. Gulraiz Ali. He's a director with IB, and he would put across his perspective. Over to you, Gulraiz Bhai.
Thank you, Atulji, our respected chairman for SEA, president. Director Mr. Mehta ji and my fellow panelists and our dear audience who have gathered in more than 300 number today. So I guess most of the content was covered by our fellow panelists earlier. Yadav has covered comprehensive data on poultry and fishery and shrimp, etc. So I'll just draw back a little perspective closer to what has happened in the COVID to poultry and what will be the scenario in the future. So we have been hit very, very hard, as Atulji spoke in the beginning of the conference today, that the poultry industry was hit by the virtual virus when the virus actually had not hit the Indian soil and there were no much cases. And we have realized how lethal is the power of the social media. And the industry has literally faced it and have lost a lot of capital. So the poultry industry were completely into ruins by the time we went into the country's lockdown announced by the respected Prime Minister. And the entire industry has lost complete capital which was infused in the market and in the production. We've been to various platforms of ministries and panels where we have represented the government and seek their support and some stimulus to boost the industry back and put it back on their feet. We do see a lot of our Prime Minister has announced with a stimulus package of 2 lakh crores to the nation, with different sectors and to the people. We'll put back some money back into the hands of the people and consumers and give the confidence back to the people of the country and the businesses to roll back and give back what was required to run the country's economy. We are very hopeful that the continuous announcements which were and announcements being made by the Finance Ministry will also cover most of our industry requirements in today, tomorrow and in the following week's announcements. Because the future is not very great in terms of the poultry industry. and because the consumption is hit very low because of the restaurants and the Horeca sector not operating at 100%. Currently, the domestic consumption is, and that is also limited to the supply, what we see in the market, because all the shops and the points of sales are 100% not operational for the meat. The point of consumption, which is primarily Horeca sector, that's hotels, airlines not operating, domestic airlines not operating. There is no floating population, domestic as well as international. There is no conference, there is no wedding, there is no major large consumption, so-called for celebrity food, what we call in the Indian terms is animal protein. It's a food for celebration when people eat much of this meat when they have to celebrate or there is a conference or there are a wedding, etc. So we don't see such positivity also in people's mind, which we have to get back to people's mind and be positive. Hopefully, we will get out of this lockdown situation soon. And we see that in the next 10 months, every month there will be a contribution from this sector by 5 to 10%, depending how is the country doing in terms of the cases of COVID-19, as well as what are the policies of the states and the government to unlock this situation. So we see a positive scenario as of now because of the demand and supply, but major stock of the poultry was destroyed during the lockdown period. And there is now a vacuum in terms of the production and availability, and also, as I mentioned, the point of sales. So vis-a-vis the demand, what is currently at 40%, what Mr. Yadav also mentioned, there is a little gap, so that the prices are a little better for the industry. However, it will not continue long because the consumer will not appreciate this pricing, what is there today of the product. So in the long run, there will be production in line, whatever is required by the market. There may be a little overproduction, which will bring the price of the product further down. However, if the continuous consumption increase trend continues, what we have mentioned about 5 to 10% every month with opening of the lockdowns in areas, this will be a positive scenario for the industry, which will translate into a positive scenario for the meal industry, because the entire meal industry, as Mr. Sodhi also mentioned, 80% is consumed by the animal sector. So today the animal sector production is down by 40%, consumption is down by 50%. And so will that result into the lower accumulation or rather consumption of oil meal in the country and put back the pressure on the solvent extraction companies. My appeal and my request would be also to the solvent extraction, especially soya industry, which is a major oil meal for the animal feed, that we need to focus on the quality, because we have better genetics being engineered. A lot of millions and millions and billions of dollars spent over the years for having better genetics, for better production of animal meat and quality of milk, etc. So all that engineering and investment goes into creating a better product, which also requires better food, better feed to feed on itself, to get a better quality meat, protein, etc. For that, we need to focus as a country to produce better meal, which will only result into better quality protein through milk or poultry or fish meat. We have been running the age-old parameters of the meal, which is 2.5% sand silica and way above average fiber and etc., which we need to also move with time with the international standards of having maximum 1% sand silica in the meal and curtail our fiber to 5% maximum, etc. These kind of quality product definitely will help our poultry industry, fish industry, and all the feed sector to have the better product, go into the better genetically bettered species what we have even in the dairy sector. So all this will really help look at India. The global players will also look at India in terms of the quality product for imports as well. We can be able to export better quantity of meal because we are already at a premium as a non-GM meal. And our prices in India are completely non-competitive to export outside There is no parity. We are almost 30 to almost on an average 35% higher in the price. And we are outpriced completely by the global exporters like the Argentina, America, and the Brazil. So there is no way we can even export the feed outside of India with these kind of input pricing of the meals. However, if we in the focus on the quality of the meal and going forward, put more focus on the R&D of developing a better non-GM seed through government or our extractors also focus to get into the R&D of having developed a better non-GM GM seed, if possible, then only there would be a possibility of having the prices lowered for the meal and give a better value even to the farmers today. Because the government's focus to double the farmers' income, which they've been striving to buy the MSP to the soya, is not going to help in the long run because it has tremendously increased the price of the feed as an input for all the complete animal husbandry and animal protein, which I see is a key factor to work upon in the future. And this COVID will teach us a lot of things because there is always a silver lining in every tragedy what has happened in the past with all the big banks to start with. There will be better life after that. So we believe and coming out of COVID, all the companies, oil meal industries, animal husbandry industries will learn and come out stronger and better and focus on what is required and not just get out of the normal norm of life and production and productivity and focus where we add value in the entire value chain of oil meals to feed and animal protein production. That is how I would like to end my speech here. And thank you everybody for listening, and you would want to have a quality product from everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ali. Very well put. You have come out as an incorrigible optimist. And I'm sure we will have better days ahead. Now, friends, we have one of the foremost commentators on the agri scene as far as India is concerned. Vijay Sardana needs no introduction. You open any television channel, he's there with his comments, with his views, which are generally not the normal ones. He's probably one of the few persons who actually thinks out of the box. Over to you, Vijay Bhai.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Atul Bhai. I hope I'm audible to all my friends and well-wishers, those who are in webinar. Thanks to for fellow panelists for raising some of the very pertinent issues in the last couple of minutes. And thank you to all the seniors and guides and friends, those who are attending this session. Sir, I am looking at something very exciting in COVID and beyond COVID. I will say that let us capitalize the crisis. This is what COVID has done to us. And I was telling in most of the places that thank you, COVID. At least you have booted all our mindsets, the way we were thinking and working. Otherwise, there was no way for 138 crore population, you can have a reboot button. The only thing what can be done is through COVID. And I think we should look at this, that yes, we are going through a churning phase. We are going through a crisis. But this is where India always performed the best. You look at the history of India, we always came out with flying color when there was a crisis. And I think this is where the India will do much better than what we were in pre-COVID era. So I am extremely optimistic, and I wrote my very first piece when I says that new world trade order and globalization is going to change. And you must have seen some of my writings, which I'm saying that this is where the India's time is now starting. I'm not going into politics. We know what is happening in China, China's relation with the world, what Trump was saying yesterday and other countries are saying. Incidentally, I'm part of various international consultation which is going on. Somewhere, there is a serious setback on the positioning of China, both mentally, physically, and economically, and also which is reflecting in political thought process around the world. The only opportunity in the world today, the biggest market available is India. And India actually... COVID. In a post-COVID era, India will be a star if we put our house in order. Coming back to the topic, I will say that my whole theme is around how to capitalize this crisis. Let me put one very simple thing, and which I always ask and I don't get answer. And again, I'm throwing that question back to all the audiences. I'm not expecting answer now, maybe later on. Why oil seeds are called oil seeds when protein content is more than the oil? And this is where a mystery, which I don't understand as a food technologist or a dairy technologist, that who gave this wrong term for a good product? Because same thing when I told Government of India that why you call more nutritious grains like wheat and rice is less nutritious than so-called coarse cereals. And we are downgrading a better product by giving a wrong name. Why not we change the terminology to Nutri-Cereal? And I'm happy that Government of India issued a notification that coarse cereals will be called Nutri-Cereals now onwards. My request to SEA, please reboot the definition and see that we have, instead of oil seed, a protein grains may be a better deal, because then consumer will have a positive thinking. We are talking about the nutrition. We all are talking about better health. And I think we will have, as a grain itself or the output itself of so-called oil seed crops, have a better value realization just by changing a name and by changing the perception. Moving next, what I'm looking at is that when we are talking about oil seeds, when we look into any oil seed today in a COVID crisis, what is today we are looking at is first line of defense is immunity. There's no vaccine, no medicine. The first line of defense is body immunity. The source of body immunity is protein. It's supported by minerals and vitamins, other micronutrients. There is no better product than oil seeds when we talk about providing nutrition in the terms of protein to the society, whether it is human life or animal life. I think we have to change the mindset that oil meal is only for livestock feeding. It is for all living being, for their better life and for increasing immunity. So what it leads to? It leads to that whatever we are able to produce so-called oil seeds and extracting oil meal out of it, this is the only component which is going to give us better realization, if I say per kg, than what is there in oil. So for the profitability of industry, I think the raw material should be, focus should be oil meal. Oil is just a commodity which is substitutable. And if you have seen around the world, even in India, people do claim their food is nutritious. Many companies, they claim their brand is nutritious. But minute oil becomes, particular oil becomes cheaper, they immediately switch from rice bran to palm. But the claim remains the same. So it means that all people, those who are making claim and using the oil that we use a healthy oil, it is only on paper. In practice, it is the cheapest oil. So fact of the matter is that oil will always be a cheapest commodity game, which is means L1 tender. L1 means no margin. So I will say that industry's viability and profitability depends upon how we manage oil meal, not the oil will continue to be consumed as a fuel in food system, because body needs energy and oil offers that energy, calorific value. So I, as a personal, even when I was running an oil industry on my own, my message to my team, both production and marketing, was oil is a byproduct. Find out the value in oil meal, capitalize that, and that will give you balance sheet bottom line, not the oils. And that always benefited in our strategy. And I request to all the audiences here, please think oil meal seriously. It will definitely give you better margins than what is there in oil. Second point of looking at is that when we are talking about oil meal, I am actually looking at it as a source of protein, both for human as well as animal segment. When we are talking of oil meal as a source of protein, we also look at that what are the comparative valuation of protein today. We look at source of protein in dal, we look at source of protein in oil meal, we look at source of protein in chicken, we look at source of protein in milk, and we look at source of protein in egg or in fish. The cost per percentage of protein is, or I will say that formula which should drive forward. Today we have to look at how high protein component should get a premium. Around the world, if you look at, in dairy segment, skim milk powder always commanded higher price than whole milk powder because whole milk had a higher fat and comparatively less protein. So what gives premium to protein? We have to relook into it, how we can capitalize in a COVID era or post-COVID era when protein is required to build immunity, which is the first line of defense. I am sure if we convince people that products made out of soya meal like soya vadi, add a whole lot of other things and other oil meal, maybe groundnut, maybe other products. We have to do a lot of innovations to make the more valued product. Today, the problem is that oil meal is considered as byproduct and no effort is going on innovation and creating value out of oil meal. So premium product called protein, we are actually throwing at a throwaway price or even below that. And which is a tragedy in the whole business model itself, that what we are doing with a premium product, why we are not able to derive or capitalize on the value which God has given to us, and why we are not able to create wealth out of it, which is premium in the crop itself. Segment, if you look at very clearly, that animal protein, I always wrote, and also to the customers in the initial days when there was too much rumor was going on, I said very clearly, the cheapest vegetable today in the market is egg curry. And egg is the best protein and the cheapest available. And what we are doing is we are spending money on a high-end product and giving a substandard product. This education to consumer will create boost for animal protein. And for animal protein, we need oil meals to support the animal protein production. So if we create a market of animal protein, immediate bulk takeoff of oil meal will start. It will be sustainable because please appreciate that no consumer wants to become sick. Everybody wants to have a strong immunity because COVID is not the first and the last incidence. We had incidences, but we never had a lockdown. But everybody is afraid that COVID may reoccur. It may happen like we are finding in different parts of the world that everything is normal down the line 6 months, but suddenly in 1 month you realize that there is an outbreak in some part of India, that area, that district or that state is lockdown or quarantine. We should be ready for that. So best way of defense is create human immunity. It means today we are in the sweet spot in COVID and post-COVID era to educate consumer what they should eat. High protein diet, which oilseed based products are offering, whether it is a livestock or oilseed or soya vadi, or we come out with many more products, or maybe blending of soya flour with wheat flour and soya flour with other combinations. I think there is a huge opportunity for us to capitalize on soya meal, or I will say that oil meals in large. Why I'm repeatedly saying soya meal? Because that's the only oil seed where some innovations have happened and we have created a human consumable options. Why we are not able to do that much in case of, if I say groundnut or tail or other issues? I'm sure we need innovation to capitalize on that opportunity. Now, coming back to an issue of soya meal quality itself. Now, it is very sad to look at it when you look at, and I am still not able to find out the reason for it. When I purchase a raw material, there is a standard of 10-2-2. Thus, 2-2 ka standard hai. Output mein bhi wohi ka wohi hai. Toh hum factory mein kar kya rahe the? Humne mitti tak nahi nikali. 2% humne mitti kharidi hai raw material mein, aur finished goods mein bhi hum 2% mitti de rahe. Toh factory kar kya rahi thi? तो कहने का मतलब ये है कि हमें समझना पड़ेगा कि जो पुरानी ट्रेडिंग प्रैक्टिसेस थी, the old way of functioning is no more valid. People will look at only bottom line कि पड़ता नहीं पड़ रहा है, मार्जिन नहीं बैठ रहा है. But point is, today think the sad scenario, all large poultry players are going backward integration, putting up their own solvent plants. This is wrong. This is sad. And you know the side effect of this? More and more integration will enhance in this country because small farmers will not be able to sustain the technological changes, the whole lot of other changes. More and more integration will happen. Sale of oil meal from floating around oil meal factories, solvent plants will go down. More and more dependency will come to a centralized in-house production because of quality reasons. Poultry is one of the most scientific industry today in any agriculture domain. And that we have to keep in mind. Here, FCR is the only sector where we virtually calculate everyday FCR. Like in solvent, we calculate the, you know, hexane consumption on a daily basis. This is the only segment where we capture FCR. It means 0.01 is a big thing in poultry, and nobody can afford a substandard input. And unless our solvent industry exercises this question, I don't think what will happen, because these same integrators will set up another factory, because that will help them in ensuring quality and performance. So unless we focus on meal quality, I don't see that where is going to be takeoff down the line when integration will rule the poultry industry. Who will buy the oil meal from rest of the oil solvent industry? So this is a warning. When your customer is setting up his own factory production facility, it means something is wrong in the supplies. And that message should be very, very clear. Second area we have to look at is price discovery. Let me tell you, sir, something which in detail I may not be able to share, but I can give you a flavor. On the instruction of PMO and Niti Aayog, there is a core committee to look into all the regulations in agri-food space. I am incidentally part of that core committee, where we have every day 2-hour meeting with top level secretaries and joint secretaries virtually on daily basis. And that the amount of work which is going on, I can simply give you a flavor that if that happens, and that's why I'm saying thank you, COVID, nobody thought of those reforms which is under discussion. Virtually every dimension is under discussion. And most of the documents are ready, most of the calculations are ready, internal brainstorming is going on, political brainstorming is going on. And hopefully you will see some interesting announcements. What will happen to the overall regulatory environment in which agriculture is working? But some of the key points which industry and policymakers have to seriously think, and there is no easy answer. And that's why I'm flagging it to you, so that we start thinking when the announcement happens, we are at least mentally ready to receive them and see how we can move forward. Number one, what is the alternate to MSP? Today, government is deciding MSP. If tomorrow we remove MSP concept and we allow trading outside APMC and there is a liberalization in agriculture trade, how price discovery will happen? Who will decide the price? And that is going to be, if prices crash, there is going to be reaction from the farming community. If there is going to be something else, the other component will react. What is going to be the right price discovery mechanism? I think across the commodities, we have to start thinking now, because we need innovative approaches here. And we have never tested, because we all were operating in a bound condition. We were never had a freedom to think around it. But I think now time has come. We have to seriously look at it, because tomorrow it may happen that before announcements, government may indirectly ask you, policymakers may ask you, what do you think, how price should be discovered for farmers? Do we have answers? There are a lot of things one has to look at it. And third point, which is another point which is very important for us to look at, is the value addition. As I mentioned initially, huge demand from consumer side for protein. Doctors will recommend increased protein intake. Can we convert our oil meal into a human grade edible portions? Maybe in blending, maybe directly, maybe some extraction, whatever. I think it is time when people are, and your R&D teams are sitting at home. There's nothing happening in quality labs most of the time. People are operating from home. At least send instruction back to your managers. Start exploring internet, how we can create value-added human edible product when it comes to oil meal. And the last point which is important for us is that competition and the profitability. We will have huge market within India. But at the same time, there are going to be large number of players. I was just addressing APO conference few days back for 21 countries. And let me tell you that there's going to be massive shortage of a lot of food item in Asian countries. And explore the new markets. There's going to be huge demand. Our conventional markets may not support us because of their financial condition, logistic challenges, etc. Asia is emerging as a major market for many of the products. Relook into country by country what you can do. And there's a huge opportunity for that. So my only point is that I will say that let us capitalize the crisis. Great days ahead. India will be much stronger, much more powerful in coming days. And is a great opportunity for us, because we are today talking about 138 crore population. And by 2024, we will supersede China easily when it comes to number of consumers in the country. So I think we are the largest market. which is underdeveloped, it means huge headspace to grow, whether we are in a position to capitalize or somebody else will come from outside to capitalize this opportunity. Rest is up to us. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, Vijay Bhai, for those very, very optimistic words. I am sure the people like you advocating India will certainly capitalize on the opportunity post-COVID. And I'm sure whosoever is listening will definitely look at capitalizing post-COVID. Now, I've been given the interesting task of summing up whatever has been spoken till now. Our first speaker today was Sodhi Saab, the Amul man. And probably dairy is one sector which has been doing exceptionally well. In fact, it was a very pleasant surprise to hear from Sodhi that Amul factories are running at more than 100% capacity. If that was not the case, I'm sure milk availability for the Gujaratis would have been a big issue in these COVID times. It was also interesting to know that the milk production in India is now almost something like 189 million tons. And in the next 10 years, Sodhi Saab estimates that India could actually be producing something like 350 million tons. Now, just imagine 350 million tons, the amount of cattle which will be there, and the huge opportunity available for us to exploit the cattle sector. Surprisingly, what has happened over the years is that oil meals directly into the cattle feed sector has not been very relevant. If you look at the China scene, in China, the big meal demand of soya actually came from swine feed or pigs. And if only we can have that kind of thing available in India, pricing would definitely be a factor in that. So there's a huge opportunity waiting for us to exploit. And if India seriously moves towards self-sufficient oil seeds, there's no reason why more oil meal may not be available. And another interesting point Sodhi Saab made was that why should you have so many channels and so many intermediaries? Why not sell directly to the big consumers? This is something which we are, as an industry, we need to seriously look at. For us, competition is also growing from other sectors like DDGS and corn gluten. So we should not rest on our laurels. Next speaker was Balram Bhai. Balram Bhai's feeling is that consumption has fallen to almost about 35% level. And chicken at one point of time was selling at 4 to 5 rupees a kilo. And that would probably have meant a lot of chicken would have been culled by the farmers themselves. And that probably has brought much more equanimity as far as the demand and supply is concerned. And the industry is now back in profit margin. The losses, according to Balram Bhai, was something like 20,000 crores in the month of February. Another interesting point which he made was that rumors have a shelf life, very short shelf life. And this is exactly what happened as far as the all the rumors which we're hearing about poultry non-vegetarian consumption as causing coronavirus and all that. It's going to be a long haul. Overnight, things are not going to improve. And we'll have to see maybe 6 to 8 months before demand comes back to the pre-COVID levels. Shrimp also, he feels, despite the initial hiccup, the demand from China has really kicked in and the shrimp industry is back in money. Among the demands, working capital needs of this sector needs to be taken care of because this corona time has been very, very troublesome. Devesh Bhai, the doyen of the soya industry, talked about the problems of the soya industry. Obviously, higher MSP is resulting in soya meal not finding a home outside India. And you can see the export numbers coming down. But what one interesting point which he made was that we need to concentrate on the niche markets. And Devesh Bhai is a firm believer that India need not and should not move from non-GMO status to genetically modified status. The jury may still not be out on that, and people may have difference of opinion, but he is a firm believer that India should stick to non-GM status. He has demanded inland freight subsidy for the simple reason that our major production area is about 800 odd kilometers away from the port towns. Devesh Bhai gave the example of pulses and how India became much more self-sufficient as far as pulses is concerned. Something similar needs to be replicated as far as the oilseed sector is concerned. And with the Prime Minister also responding that India needs to move towards self-reliance, I think it's high time Government of India put in place, put in motion the national mission on oil and oil seeds, which has been hanging fire and gathering dust in the corridors of Agriculture Department. I think that is something which the policymakers need to seriously look at. No taxes on export is a long-standing demand because India doesn't need to export taxes out of the country. So meal exports need to be freed from all taxes. India has the potential to increase its productivity from 1 ton per hectare to 2 tons per hectare. Right kind of trust is given. And the long-standing demand of restoring incentive for meal exports to 10% was also raised by him. Gulrez Ali, again, was an incorrigible optimist. He feels that the Horeca segment has definitely resulted in lower meal demand across because out-of-home consumption and marriages and celebrations where meat gets consumed, that has come off. Obviously, once the corona effect is over, then this segment will start looking up. He also made a very interesting point that it's important that the feed quality is improved. And this is one point in which Vijay Bhai also stressed much more that it's high time the industry started ensuring that the meal quality is good and they don't muck around by adding sand, silica or whatever, because that is not what a meal is supposed to have. Last but not the least, Vijay Bhai Sardana. He is always a person who thinks out of the box. He feels it's the best time for India going forward and it's the best time to reboot and capitalize on the COVID experience. He's definitely optimistic about India. Obviously, as a throwback, because China seems to be now the whipping boy of the world. So the next best country as far in terms of number of people and the market size is obviously India. You can't have a bigger market than India, 138 crore people or something like 1.38 billion people. He made a very interesting point that oil is substitutable, and that's a fact. Meal or protein is not. And for years, we've been always talking in terms of meal as a byproduct and oil as the main product. I think it's high time. He suggested that we start looking more seriously at the meal and its quality and change the way of thinking and working. He also shared with us that various reforms for our sector are under discussion and will probably be announced shortly. My only suggestion and request is, I hope they are reforms and not more regulations, because more regulation means you end up screwing the sector, and where you have more regulation, it is actually strangulation. So, because he's on the board or he's on one of the, you know, committees, I hope he will put the industry point across in that. Value addition is something which we need to look at. Very well summarized. I think we've had a wonderful session. Now I'll pass on this to our young Dr. Mehta to take over. Mehta ji, now you can take on the questions and then also give your vote of thanks. Over to Mehta ji.
I have a lot of questions, so I'll address one by one to the panelists. And please try to be brief for 2 minutes, your reply, because we have many questions. So please try to be brief to our panel. My request. Now my first question to Mr. Balram. As supply chain is buzzword during COVID-19, what innovation you look for the industry with the supply chain management?
Innovations and revolution will happen is how we serve the consumer as far as food is concerned. And that will have a great bearing for this section, the entire animal protein sector. If you see, one of the great things about this country is that even though we eat a lot outside, but we haven't forgotten cooking. So I think if you see in last few weeks, we have seen companies which deliver food or semi-cooked food directly to the farmers, to the consumers, have just... I would say are having unprecedented traction. So I think the way we serve the consumer will be very, very important. There will be a big surge which will be foods,
Vijay,
and ready to cook, ready to eat foods delivered at home. So I'm saying that a lot of these startups like Swiggy, Zomato, direct to home, Licious, etc. We are seeing a lot of traction in these areas. We also will see a little bit of more surge in the safety and hygiene food consumption. So I hope that processed food in all categories will get some kind of improved sales in time to come. And I think that from the supply chain point of view, it is extremely clear that wherever we are able to manage the supply chain well, particularly if you see, Sodhi Saab gave an example of milk, the consumption can be kept intact. And that is what happened in milk. But I think similar things have to happen in all the other animal proteins. Having said that, yes, it will not be the same world again. And my sense is that it will improve for the better as far as food is concerned. It will be a very, very important change in terms of processing. The second thing is that, as Vijay said, that protein and immunity are now interchangeable words. Innumerable WhatsApp university messages as well as television programs are saying that. So whether it is vegetarian protein or it is non-vegetarian protein will get a lot more focus. The only thing is that how we deliver that in a very hygienic and a very good way is very important. I must also tell you that let us not get carried away by the word protein also. I had gone to one seminar in Singapore because everybody talked about protein and everybody said that why things are slow in India. So one of the things is that you go abroad, everybody say will offer you a plate of chicken and say, have some protein. Indians don't eat protein, carbohydrates, etc. We eat food. So everything has to be converted into food for us. So that is, I think, most important for companies like ours and companies in food processing or who want to get into food processing. More regulation should come from the food safety point of view. This is a great opportunity for government to probably tighten them, and I think they should not miss this opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Balram. Now, next question is to Mr. Goldrich and Mr. Vijay Sadana. Any package coming specific for the poultry industry and poultry farmer?
I would like Mr. Vijay to answer this question because we
the same issue. He is a master.
After a regular call. And
let me tell you that. Okay. Vijayji. Thank you, Gulrez. Let me supplement what you have said. Definitely, there is a lot of calculations and things have gone into poultry segment. Repeatedly, I think we were interacting with the policy makers. Today, in fact, why Joint Secretary is not here? Because the same discussion is going on with the minister on the package for poultry segment. Yesterday, we saw a small development that Kisan Credit Card, now livestock farmers are included into Kisan Credit Card domain, which was not there earlier. So one step forward for the poultry and aquaculture segment. Regarding other packages, there are two ways of looking at it. One is the interest subversion, which is in a very serious consideration, that how we can revive the industry by reducing. Gulrez and myself, we have calculated in detail with all the parameters that if Government of India give a sensible consideration of what the industry is asking, maybe hardly 5,000 crore in 2 years, not even overnight, in 2 years, 1,25,000 crore worth industry can be saved. Not only poultry, but allied activities, which we have communicated very clearly, whether it is oil mill industry, maize industry, and other allied industry. So all calculations are there with the government. All positive messages are there. This is now the last political call which is pending. And we have to wait for that because I'm not a politician, so I can't take their way of thinking. Remaining things we have done, all messages are properly conveyed with proper calculation, justification, scientific, economic, political, and a whole lot of things. So let us hope, and I'm positive, and let's see what political call comes on that request. But from your side, I think you must compliment Gulrez and his team for doing all the calculations and all the detailed, even up to midnight, we were arguing and calculating and rechecking the facts and passing on to the government in early morning meetings. So I think whatever industry wanted to say is properly conveyed. Rest is the political call.
Okay. Thank you, Vijay. One more question from Balram sir. Approximately how much time poultry industry will take to see the improvement in soya and protein demand? Am I clear?
Yeah. Balram? So let me break the poultry industry in two parts. First one, let me talk about the layer, which is the egg. So India produces about 110 billion eggs, which works out to about 225 crore eggs per week. So this is the kind of numbers we are talking about in this country. When you roll back this number, it comes to about 10 to 11 million tons of feed, and when you put oil meal into it, it means 4-5 million tons of oil meal. My sense is, and I think other players can also contribute, is that the egg industry did not suffer to the same extent as the chicken industry suffered. Of course, there was a very big dip for a few weeks, but egg prices have come back, and so the production will also come back because there are biological ways of reducing egg production. We call it molting, where we don't feed the bird, so feed the bird stops producing and starts protecting itself, and that is a normal tendency of any very living being, but it comes back into production when the feed is restored. So egg production is rising, so I do not see. The other thing is that only thing which government has to do, most of the state governments have to restore midday meal scheme so that egg consumption also comes back. So if that happens, my sense is by June, your layer feed demand will come back to almost 90% of normal and your oil meal supply will be restored there. Second thing is chicken industry, 35 to 40% is back. Retail used to be only about 50% of the total industry of 70,000 crores. So even if retail will grow because in-home consumption will increase, but will never be able to fill that gap which has been created. So my sense is if the COVID situation improves slowly, we will have 60-65% consumption back by July, but it will not improve further because Shravan will set in and we will have 2-3 months of lower consumption. Let me also tell you that what Gulrez said is absolutely right, that this is a celebratory food. And I must tell you, in one of the webinars about 3 weeks ago, somebody asked me, what can one thing happen which will increase the demand of poultry in the short run? And I said alcohol consumption should start. And everybody knows here that on the day when alcohol started, next day poultry prices jumped between 15% to 25% in different states. So this is the real celebratory food for India. My friends, 100% consumption, broiler feed consumption is 12-13 million tons a year. Today, it has come down to 5-6 million tons. And you can calculate it is about 40-45% is oil meal in that. So you can calculate your consumption. But if COVID situation improves, there is a solution where celebrations start. We start getting back into parties, fedding start, everything starts. That is still, according to me, 9 to 10 months away. And that is the time you will see improved consumption back to normal. Till that time, we will have to suffer. So that I can say. It will improve by 5-6% every month. It will be a standstill during Shravan months. But there will be a surge towards the end of the year, definitely. Because if not the vaccine, but I am very sure that human endeavor will make sure that we get some kind of a treatment for COVID which reduces mortality. So this flu, we will not worry about getting sick. We are more worried about dying. So if that worry goes, people will come out and celebrate.
Very, very good.
Thank you, Balram, for an extraordinary suggestion. I think Atul Bhai would like to add something.
No, it's an excellent.
Atul Bhai, would you like to say something? Or I'll go ahead with the next question.
What Balram Bhai has said is excellent. But how do the Gujaratis start eating meat? Because we are in a state which is as prohibition.
Sir, I did my MBA there for 2 years. I know, sir.
the government is much higher than in the states, yeah. Acha, now I have the next question to Davis Bhai. Davis Bhai, the future price outlook of soya meal and other oil mills, and particularly when export is down, how do we cope up with the extra production or extra surplus of the soybean meal in domestic market? Am I clear, Davis Bhai?
Acha, okay. Is it okay? Is it audible now?
Yeah.
Is it audible? Yeah. Okay.
Yes, sir.
We have a very, I think, sizable residual stock of soybean available with us at this time. What we have actually estimated that 1st of May, stocks for the current crop year could be somewhere around 4 million tons. And that translates into about 3 million tons of meal. About 3 to 3.2 million tons. So that is a sizable available stock. As a matter of fact, if the exports remain scanty as we have seen so far, then I think there is a very, clear availability, you know, for the domestic needs. Although our soybean crushing has been aligned to actual offtake, the demand which is there from the poultry industry and from the agriculture and from the food industry. So all put together, I personally feel that we cannot see any run on the prices really. At this time, the prices should remain at a level, at least not more than what is being offered currently. Rather, it may, with the onset of the, after the sowings commence, the prices can start sliding a bit and you can see some kind of, reversal in the price of 5% or so.
I have a supplementary question to Balram. That you can increase the local consumption of soybean meal in the poultry feed or cattle feed. I believe that you are using about 22% soybean meal currently. I think Gulraj also can supplement. Can they increase the percentage of usage of the domestic oil meal, particularly soybean meal, in the poultry feed?
Gulraj, you want to go first?
Yes, so you, as you rightly said, Mehta ji, that 20 to 22% is the right inclusion of soya meal in the poultry feed. However, we have been seeing that the inclusion of soya has been supplemented by some equal source of oil meal. rapeseed, etc. Because of the pricing what we have today in India. However, the scientific and the most approved inclusion percentage is 22, and going above that will increase the cost and will not change the digestibility of the protein in the animal. We keep the maize percentage at 60 to 65% inclusion, and that is the right combination with the different amino acids and additional nutrients in the food. However, I think we see a much gain in terms of getting more protein meal instead of using quality protein, which will make the feed better. No improvement of adding more meat, rather percentage of protein is what matters to be added.
Okay, Balram Saab, you want to add something? Yeah, Balram Saab.
To all my soya extraction friends, I just want to tell you that for a feed miller or for an integrator, we are, whenever we look at our feed cost, our only focus is to reduce soya meal inclusion by any possible way, by through animal protein route or through substituting with other proteins, etc. Because the, as so many people pointed out, the quality cost ratio is not very good for this meal, according to us. Unfortunately, nutrition is progressing and genetics is progressing in a direction where we strongly feel that in time to come, we all will be able to probably reduce inclusion of soya meal more and more. I think this is something I want to give you a feedback. Whenever we talk about cost of feed, first discussion is soya meal.
Okay. Thank you. We have a last...
One more point here, which is very focused on and supplementing Balram Ji's thought, that in the animal feed industry, the animal feed, the protein percentage is nothing less than an octane value of petrol. The more octane value of petrol determines the better efficiency of that petrol to that engine. The way we are improving the genetics of the animal, the way we have improved technology in the current turbines and engines, we need better fuel to run it. Like the better, and it requires better octane fuel than petrol. Similarly, we need better protein. At this price, it's very difficult for us to prepare that kind of feed. And we have to supplement it by different ways.
Okay. Thank you. This is the last question to Vijay ji. Government has laid emphasis on self-reliance. How do you foresee the future of technology infusion in domestic India, which has been locally developed, like a plant and machinery development, indigenously, etc.? Can you comment on that?
I think it's a very...
Am I clear, Vijay?
Yes, sir. I think it's a very, very important message which Honorable Prime Minister has given of self-reliance. Remember the days when we were talking about doubling farmers' income. What has happened, the whole country was talking on that theme. And same thing I was observing, and that's precisely I was making notes, that minute the Prime Minister mentioned that India should go through self-reliance, very next minute, soon after that, I had 5 TV channels and all were talking only self-reliance. No COVID, nothing else. So what has happened that everyone started talking about self-reliant, whether it is a small person, big person, politician, bureaucrat, industry, consumer, supplier, farmer, everyone. I think this has given a trigger to the mindset that I think we have to look differently. And I'm sure, as you rightly said, the technology supplier, one of the sad part of India today is, irrespective of the industries, I was business head of Tetra Pak in India. I was part of Alpha Level. Except basic fabrication, every key component was imported. And what we have to do now in this country, if we today, why today dairy industry is successful? Because we created, Dr. Kurian created DMRC, and which is part of NDDB, producing local equipment and machinery. So you have a cost-effective machinery, local services, local spares, and local maintenance. Why other technologies were not penetrated? Because one of the major problems is that first is capital cost, then maintenance cost, and then for everything you have to get an engineer from outside or spare part from outside. One area which I see is a big area with food industry, whether it is poultry, feed, byproduct, extrusion, whatever you call it. Some of us should seriously look at development and innovation in processing technologies and machine fabrication. Sugar industry did it, they are benefiting. Whichever industry has done it, benefiting because your capital cost goes down. Why today broiler industry is suffering? Because we already had 41 or 42 processing plants in the country, processing something about 1 lakh birds an hour. Most of these machines are imported, expensive. Think of reducing the cost of these capital goods by 1/3. Every district will have its own processing unit. Today, consumers are worried about going to a nearby slaughterhouse and buying a wet market because of a lot of rumors. Tomorrow, think of a scenario with every poultry company is doing its own processing in their own brand and selling chicken like ice cream in cold cabinets, going door to door, and somebody can come down and pick up a packet of a chicken which says 50 rupees, 100 rupees, 200 rupees, and consume the product. I think without technology, we will not be able to capitalize. Customers are not willing to go to slaughterhouses on the roadside. They want hygienic product in-house whenever they want. And there is a huge opportunity, and that's what I'm saying. This is a crisis to conversion into opportunity. And this is where the reliance of India will open up a lot many fronts which were unexplored. And we should look at this in a positive way.
Thank you, Vijay. This was the last question. I had a number of questions. Unfortunately, because of the time limitations, we have to close this question answer session. And let me allow to put a vote of thanks to all my panelists. Thank you very much, all panelists, and also the participants for joining this day. We'll be hosting the entire proceeding on SCA website as well as the global website in a day or two. Before I say good day to everybody, let me inform that in coming weeks, SCA Global will be hosting the webinars continuously on the different subjects like rapeseed, like rice bran, vegetable refining, marketing of the FMGC product, FSIs, and others. And we'll keep you informed about the date and the time, and we'll be happy to have you again once again. Thank you very much, all panelists and participants, to be with us today. God bless you.
And keep you on your toes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, I missed in between. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
No, but Sodhi, your presentation was excellent. People are really appreciated. I could see the number of the questions we have. But since you are missing, I didn't ask you the question. And of course, Mr. Balram has replied on your behalf also some questions.
Thank you. I had.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
The Solvent Extractors Association of India and Global presents Song of Harmony on behalf of the entire edible oil industry, dedicated towards our nation and humanity.
हमने सर पे ये केसरी रंग सजाया
है मेरी जमीन अफसोस नहीं जो तेरे लिए सौ दर्द सहे महफूज रहे तेरी आन सदा चाहे जान मेरी ये रहे ना रहे
पड़े कभी रंग तेरा जिस्मों से निकल के खून कहे तेरी मिट्टी में मिल जावा गुल बन के मैं खिल जावा इतनी सी है दिल की आरजू तेरी नदियों में बह जावा तेरे खेतों में लहरावा इतनी सी है दिल की आरज़ू सरसों से भरे खलियान मेरे जहाँ झूम के भंगड़ा पा न सका आबाद रहे वो गांव मेरा जहाँ लौट के वापस जा न सका ओ वतनावे मेरे वतनावे तेरा मेरा प्यार निराला था कुर्बान हुआ तेरी असमत पे मैं कितना नसीबों वाला था तेरी मिट्टी में मिल जावा गुल बन के मैं खिल जावा इतनी सी है दिल की आरज़ू
Ladies and gentlemen, it is our pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar on the demand-supply situation of oil mills and future outlook, brought to you by the Solvent Extractors Association of India and Globe Oil.